Thank you. The next item of business is topical questions. If a member wishes to seek a supplementary, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question by entering the letters RTS in the chat function if online. Succinct questions and answers are always looked for to get as many members in as possible. And at question number one, I call Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the public sector workforce reductions predicted by the Finance Secretary on Sunday.
Minister Tom Arthur.
The UK Government's autumn statement is one of austerity for public services. The Chancellor chose to ignore much-needed funding for public services in his budget, other than the £10.8 million of consequentials for health. We have had 2 years of high inflation, and because of this, public sector pay deals have exceeded our planned expenditure. We welcome the recent report from Audit Scotland on the Scottish Government's workforce challenges and recognise the challenge it has set out. Growth in the public sector workforce is due to a range of factors, and we are committed to providing high-quality public services. But our financial position necessitates that we need to look at reforms in the way that public bodies deliver services. The Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance will set out a further update in the draft Scottish Budget 2024-25.
Tanya Johnson.
The Deputy First Minister's comments in the media over the weekend will cause anxiety and nervousness for public servants across Scotland, just as winter costs start to bite. They deserve clarity and candour from this government. So can I ask, what level of detail are the Scottish Government's plans to reduce headcount, and will they be laid before Parliament in detail? What areas of focus are there going to be for these reductions, given that the NHS headcount will be protected? And finally, will the Minister guarantee there will be no compulsory redundancies and indeed agree to meet with trade unions as called for by the GMB?
Minister.
We are in this situation because of a range of factors. Clearly, the impact of inflation has been significant, but we are also here because of the decisions taken by the UK Government. As the Deputy First Minister has already stated, we are committed to protecting health and we want to avoid compulsory redundancies. And of course, we are committed to engaging constructively with all of our partners across the public sector to achieve those aims and ambitions. With regards to a further update, as I said in my original answer, the Deputy First Minister will provide more information as part of the Scottish Budget process.
Daniel Johnson.
In his answers, the Minister's phrase, a range of factors, is doing a huge amount of work. The reality is this announcement brings into real question the Government's competence and lack of workforce planning. As the Minister knows, since 2019, civil service headcount in devolved areas has increased by almost 40%, an increase of over 7,000. That's at a time when NHS headcount grew just by 11%. As Scottish Government core headcount increased by 2,000, that's a third. Throughout COVID, the Government was adamant that COVID money was only being used on non-recurring items. But is that the case? Given the coincidence, was this money being used to grow headcount numbers? And more importantly, is it not grossly incompetent, if not outright cruel, to create positions only to have to remove them just months later?
Minister.
Well, what I would say is incompetent is the UK Government's handling of the UK economy, and what I would say is cruel is the budgetary decisions they have taken. Now, the reality is, with regards to the spending of public money during the COVID pandemic, as with every aspect of public finances, these are set out in a transparent process through the annual budget process and, of course, in the audited accounts that are published. I recognise that we are in an exceptionally challenging set of circumstances, but it is not unique to Scotland. Indeed, our colleagues in Wales are wrestling with very similar challenges, which is a reflection, yes, of broader macroeconomic factors, but also the decisions of the UK Government.
Supplementary, Liz Smith.
The Minister is well aware that the Finance Committee has spent a great deal of its time on the question of public sector reform and questioning how this can happen. Can I ask the Minister what principles does he believe should underpin that public sector reform?
Minister.
It is a very important question, and we have committed to a 10-year programme of public service reform. But underpinning that, of course, is a desire to ensure that we are delivering more efficient, person-centred services and, of course, that we put prevention at the heart of it. And I think we would recognise that that is a shared ambition and it is one we are committed to working constructively with partners across the public sector to deliver.
Supplementary, Willie Rennie.
This is a woeful set of explanations from the Minister. They have been warned for years by the Scottish Fiscal Commission and also by Audit Scotland about the black hole in the public finances, but they kept on recruiting people into the public services. They should be apologising to the people whose jobs are under threat now, not looking to blame Westminster. I think we need a proper explanation from the Minister. When are we going to get it?
Minister.
As I set out in my original answer, there will be further information provided as part of the budget process. But we cannot escape the circumstances that we have found ourselves in over the last 2 years, which is exceptionally high inflation, which has necessitated public sector pay deals, which have put additional unanticipated pressure on the public finances. And we are now having to contend with a return to the austerity agenda of the UK government that was last, is even in excess of the austerity agenda that was pursued by George Osborne and indeed Mr Rennie's party when they were in government too.
Supplementary, John Mason.
Thank you. Can the Minister say anything about the OBR forecasts last week? And also, could the autumn statement have done more to help Scotland's finances and protect jobs?
Minister.
Yes, well, the Member's right to highlight it as a grim set of forecasts which underline, yes, as I've said before, the significant external factors, but also the mismanagement of the UK economy by the UK government. As I say, we would want to see a public spending settlement that recognises the importance of investment and protecting jobs and supporting public service reform, but that is something that the UK government have failed to recognise in their spending plans.
And I can squeeze in a brief supplementary. Stephen Kerr.
The Minister is giving a very bad impression of someone who has sloppy shoulder syndrome, blaming everybody but themselves for the situation that we're in. Does he understand and accept that if the government does not fully fund the council tax freeze that the First Minister announced without any consultation with anybody, then there will be dire consequences for jobs and services from local government?
Minister.
We have committed to fully funding the council tax freeze. That is why we are engaging constructively with our partners in COSLA. And we are committed, as I say, to delivering that. What is creating particular challenges in the context we're in currently, ahead of setting our own budget next month, is the fact that we have had such a paltry, pathetic settlement from the UK government, which is not commensurate to the challenges that we face.
Thank you. I move to question number two, Jamie Green.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government further to the Finance Secretary's letter to the Finance and Public Administration Committee on 21st November, whether it will provide an update on the delivery of vessels and piers projects, including the small vessels replacement programme and the port works at Ardrossan and Gourock harbours.
Minister Fiona Hislop.
The Government remains committed to the funding of new vessels and port infrastructure to support our lifeline ferry services. The small vessels replacement programme is progressing well, and as CMAL have confirmed, it remains on track with the outline business case for phase one nearing completion before it moves into the procurement phase. This is a crucial part of the process, helping ensure we deliver value for money and that vessels and shoreside works align. Recent confirmation of in-year budgets does not impact on the overall delivery of key investments in these new ferries for our island communities, as first payments will not be due until contracts are actually awarded. The business case for Ardrossan and scope of the Gourock port projects are under review to help inform robust investment decisions. The different partners in the Ardrossan project have further work to do in the process following the pause in procurement late in the summer, as the scope of the necessary work has been extended. I have recently written to the Ardrossan Task Force members on this work. We continue to make significant investments across our networks, with working with CMAL and the operators to improve reliability and resilience of services as we progress. There has been extensive work from CMAL in the design and business case development of the small vessel replacement programme over the summer and autumn, including island community consultation and working with Transport Scotland. The work is progressing well to the next planned stage of procurement.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Minister for the update? Let me probe a little bit about what on track actually means in the real world, because the Scottish Government investment plan update some 2 years ago made categoric commitments that seven vessels of the small vessel replacement scheme would be, I quote, serving island communities within the next 5 years, i.e. by 2026. The CMAL chief executive responded by saying, we are not prepared to wait and wait and wait and see small vessels getting older and older. But of course, they also confirmed this weekend, as we've heard in the chamber today, that payments will only be made once the shipbuilding contract is signed. And it seems like that whole process has been pushed back a year, because if the payment follows the contract, surely the work will only start once the contract has been signed. So the obvious question is this: in light of the reprofiling, as it is being called, will our island communities see all of these vessels in service by 2026, as was originally planned, and for the sake of Scotland's shipbuilding yards, including Ferguson Marine in Inverclyde, who on earth is going to build these ships?
And could I remind members of the need to comply with the time allocated, both on part of the Minister in terms of ministerial reply and in terms of the supplementary question from the member? Minister.
So I think in relation to CMAL's published corporate plan of 2020 to 23, that would have indicated an earlier start date, but I think we all understand why those plans would not have been delivered. In terms of what CMAL are asking for, they want to have progress, so do I. We're working with CMAL very closely. It's one of the first things I did when I came into office, was to visit CMAL and to understand what the plans were for this programme. So in terms of the delivery of the vessels, clearly we're in the stage that CMAL thought we would be in, which is the completion of the outline business case and design and the move into procurement. And in relation to the delivery of those vessels, we are delivering the funding for the overall vessel programme that we said we'd do between 2021 and 2026. The small vessel replacement programme will commence the building in 2026 with the delivery in those following 2 years, which is the current plan and which was set out by CMAL.
Jamie Green.
So the funding has been promised, but the delivery of the vessels is really what people are interested in. When will the vessels be sailing around their communities? And it sounds like we're talking at least 2028, and I'm sure that will come as a huge disappointment to our island communities. Of course, the harbour improvements, which are also much needed, include Ardrossan and Gourock upgrades. We were told that the Ardrossan harbour redevelopment would be finished construction by spring or summer 2026. I'd quite like an update on whether that's still on track and on plan. But all of this contradicts comments made in the letter to the Finance Committee by Shona Robison, that this reprofiling will, I quote, push out timescales of future improvements. So my next question is this: what future improvements will be pushed out or delayed in other parlance? And are these harbour redevelopment plans also going to be delayed, or are they apparently on track as well?
Minister.
So vessels will be being delivered from 2026 as planned. There will be important alignment between the overall vessel procurement and also shoreside investments, which includes harbour side investments, because that obviously includes the fact that we are going to be moving to, we want to move to electric ferries in terms of our desire to improve the system. In relation to Ardrossan, bear with me, there's a lot of detail in the questions that were asked, Presiding Officer. He will know, as was outlined, I've outlined it in this chamber, that the improvement works will need to be extended from the original investment proposal. The replacement or strengthening of the Winton Pier at Drossen and the Irish Berth, which in certain wind conditions ferries used to manoeuvre out of the harbour, has expanded that piece of work. And both North Ayrshire Council and also Peel Ports, as the partners in that process, are delivering ongoing work to make sure that we've got the robust investment decision that we can make.
Thank you, Minister. I need to go to the supplementary from Stuart McMillan. Stuart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be very much aware of my support for the workforce of Ferguson's and also the yard itself, and also how vital the small vessel replacement programme is with regards to Ferguson's, particularly with their history of the three hybrid ferries. In addition to what has been said so far, can the Minister provide an assurance that the announcement of the programme will actually happen early in the next financial year, and the Minister will be aware of the correspondence sent from local MP Ronnie Cowan, Councillor Elizabeth Robertson and myself to the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy, and will she agree to meet with three of us to discuss the small vessel replacement programme?
Minister.
So, clearly, the Stuart McMillan wants to advocate for his constituents and the Ferguson Marine Yard, which he continues to do. Clearly, in terms of that yard, it has to focus on winning future work and getting itself into the state that it can win future work. In relation to Ferguson Marine, the lead minister is Cabinet Secretary Neil Gree, who I understand has been in correspondence with the member. Clearly, our focus in Ferguson Marine has to be to secure the two new ferries, make sure that we've got the future for the yard and to serve the island communities. There are opportunities quite clearly in relation to procurement of the new small vessel replacements in terms of the needs of islanders and the needs of the local economy that he represents. I understand that relationship. We are considering future vessel contracts from public agencies on a case-by-case basis, and I understand the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy had an invitation to meet with him. I hear there's an extension to meet with me. I would need to reflect on what stage we are in terms of the procurement as to whether that might be appropriate.
Thank you, Minister. And supplementary, briefly, Katie Clark.
Adrosson waited 6 years for the Scottish Government to agree terms with Peel, whilst ministers refused to agree to the calls to bring the port back into public ownership to make progress. There's now real concern that Adrosson is going to lose out to Troon permanently. What is the Scottish Government doing to ensure urgent consideration of a business case for the essential works at Adrosson Harbour, and why has this work been left so late?
Minister.
Well, clearly the issue of public ownership is a different one necessarily to the progress of the different partners in delivering the works that would be required for Adrosson. In relation to my responsibilities since I've been in post, I've wanted to make sure that we have got the most robust business case we can. For example, North Ayrshire Council have been liaising with the Isle of Arran Ferry Committee and have appointed consultants to provide a report. That won't be available until late November, so we couldn't deliver in terms of that business case as of now, but that's what partnership working is about. There are more than one partner involved in this, and we've been working with them and also Peel Ports and looking at the extension of the need for the Winton Pier and the Irish Berth, which would not have been in the original proposals that she had reflected on.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes topical questions, and we will now move on to the next item of business after a short pause to allow front bench teams to change positions should they wish. Thank you.